The African Union Commission elections are scheduled for February the 7th in the Ethiopian capital, Addis Ababa. They are, however, facing a significant amount of public outcry due to the fact that for the first time in its history, the incumbent chairman, Faki Moussa Mahamat of Chad, is running unopposed for a second four-year term. One organization that's been campaigning to have other candidates included is the Coalition of Supporters Unions of Africa, COSUA. I spoke earlier to the organization's founder and president, Advocate Sarfo, Abebrese.
You know, my organization, the Coalition of Supporters Unions of Africa, that is a partner to the African Union, we have been working very hard to try and get a semblance of democracy, you know, in terms of selecting who the leader of Africa should be, you know, for the next 4 years. So we've been filing petitions and having a lot of work done because we've had quite a bit to say, you know, about the fact that Africa for the first time is having a single candidate, you know, for the chairmanship. We have Mr. Faki Moussa Mahamat as the unopposed candidate running for the chairmanship of the commission. And we believe that that is not representative and that is not democratic. And it's not just that we believe, but we also want to stick, you know, to precedence, because 4 years down the line, 4 years ago, we had three candidates and it was deemed to be unrepresentative enough. And so the elections were postponed for two more candidates coming. So we think that that precedent should be followed. And incidentally, that precedent was set by the then chairperson, Madam Zuma, from South Africa. And we don't understand why currently we have just one candidate and they are still going ahead with the elections. But try as we've done, it is still, we've beaten a lot of adamants all over the place. And so we barely, less than 2 weeks to go to the elections, we are having a situation where it is still one candidate running for the chairmanship position.
How has it happened that there's only one candidate? Okay. There are a number of regions on the continent, and I believe each region, five if I'm not mistaken, has the opportunity to put forward a candidate. Why is there only one candidate this time around?
Well, there's been a lot of backroom endeavors, as we understand. There's been a lot of arm twisting and all that. At least from our perspective, as the African Union partner organization, what we know is that at least there were two candidates that were in the offing. You know, first of all, to talk about the current deputy chairperson in the person of Mr. Lawyer Persikote, who is the deputy chairperson, and also Madam Arikana Chiombo-Ripao. We believe that a lot of backroom maneuverings have happened to ensure that none of them could be put on the ballot paper as a candidate, you know, for the election. So at the end of the day, we still have only one candidate, and that is the incumbent, Faki Moussa Mahamat.
Backroom shenanigans, does that mean that countries, whole countries, governments have conspired to make sure that the incumbent remains as AU chair and is the only candidate?
Well, we have strong suspicions in that regard, because you know, we have a ballot paper that looks very, very good. We have up to about eight candidates that are running for the deputy chairperson position. We have over 100 candidates that put in their nominations for the various, commissioner positions. So this is a very, very, this is a very representative election. If you look at all the other positions, you wonder how come for the chairperson alone, we have only one candidate. And as I said, we are privy to some information as to how it came about. But at the moment, we're not passing the buck. We're not pointing at any accusing finger. But we think that there's still one last chance for democracy to prevail. And that last chance is for His Excellency Faki Moussa Mahamat not to garner, you know, the required two-thirds majority vote, because that is the only way we can get the elections back on track by way of a statutory postponement. And when that happens for the 6 months, then the door will be reopened for other nominees to come in.
All right. So who are you appealing to then? It sounds like it's the voters, which is the heads of state.
Sure. Now we're making a direct appeal to His Excellency, the heads of state, trying to let them understand that they deserve a choice. They deserve a choice. The same way they are being given a choice, you know, in terms of who they pick as the vice chair, as the commissioner for trade and industry, for this, that, that, that. In the same way, they deserve a choice as to who they pick, you know, to be the chairperson. So they've been denied that choice by being presented with a ballot paper that has only one name and one face of it. And we are saying that that is not democratic. It is going to be a very, very bad precedence for Africa to deal with in future if we allow this kind of, you know, undemocratic election to take place like this. If you just tie their hands and give them, you know, just one person and force them to vote for that person, you are denying them the choice.
Do you think that these heads of state are unaware of the situation, that they're only going to find out on election day? Surely you must have made some representations, at least to the president, the current chairperson of the African Union, President Ramaphosa.
Well, yes, we've done that. We've had a lot of discussions around the table with many other representatives. And at the moment, we are also trying to engage all the ambassadors in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia, where the African Union is headquartered. I wouldn't say that the heads of states are not aware. They are. But I believe that, you know, from the perspective of my organization, that a lot of, you know, influence are being exerted even from outside the borders of Africa, you know, from foreign superpowers to try and get the situation the way it is. And that is why we are appealing to our heads of states to stand up, you know, for the people of Africa, because that this is our cry, and we want them to reject whatever foreign machinations and influence that are being exerted on them. They know they are going into an election where they are being forced to endorse an unopposed candidate. And we just want them to see it as an insult, you know, for a foreign superpower to maneuver in such a way that they are presenting to them a ballot paper that has only one candidate on it. In any part of Africa, you know, as we keep saying, if you present a defeated bed to your elder and ask the elder to leave the bed, that is an insult. That is exactly what France and, you know, their hand-picked crony in the form of Faki Moussa Mahamat is trying to do to our leaders. We love them, and we love to, I mean, move ahead with them, and we want them to see the insult for what it is and to reject it and not vote at all. Because once you cast a vote, it means you don't have a choice and you are voting for only one candidate. They need to have a choice. And we want them to insist on it, that, okay, we don't vote at all. And if we don't vote at all, and that is what we mean by the Catch-19 agenda, that if we can get 19 heads of states that will decline to vote, to see the insult that is in what is being presented to them, then we get a reprieve for the continent of Africa, because then the election now goes into a second round runoff, and other candidates come in. If they have representation, you know, and there are more than 2, 3, 4 candidates on the ballot, and they still choose Faki Moussa Mahamat, we are fine with it. But our leaders have to be given a choice. And that is what we're crying about at the moment.
Let's be clear, because you have mentioned a few things. One of them was foreign machinations, and you talked about France. Are you saying that France is the one that's pushing for Mr. Mahamat to continue and effectively influence the outcome of an African election?
Well, that is very clear. It is in the public domain and everybody knows it. And I believe that His Excellency that we are appealing to at the moment also know it. I mean, this whole thing started from a couple of years back when France was exposed by then African Union Ambassador to the United States, Madame Arikana Chiombo-Rikpa, as siphoning the billions of dollars from the Francophone African countries. And Madame Chiombo-Rikpa went out with it. And surprisingly, Faki Moussa Mahamat, who is the African Union chairperson, was, ostensibly under the influence of France, came out to fire her, somebody that was rather defending Africa. So since then, a lot of water has passed under the bridge, and everybody that is following the politics of the African Union knows that Faki Moussa Mahamat is just sitting there as a prodigy of France and doing France's bidding. And that is why we are calling for his rejection. And we believe that the current situation where Faki Moussa Mahamat, remember, he is also from a Francophone country, and everybody knows that for the past 3 decades, we have had, it's only one Anglophone leader that we've had, and that was Madame Zuma from South Africa. We've had 5 or 6 Francophone leaders heading the African Union Commission, you know, year after year for each 4-year term. So we all know that France has managed to put its paws right there on the African Union Commission. And so, incidentally, the only Anglophone leader that came up that did something memorable for Africa in terms of democratic rule, Madame Zuma, as I said, 4 years down the line, she put her feet down and said, we need a representative ballot. And so 3 is not enough. Our cry is that our other African heads of states now should see the wisdom in her decision and say that if 3 was not enough, democratic and representative enough, how can 1 be democratic and representative enough? And hear our cry and decline the vote on the 7th of February so that we get democracy back on track in Africa.
All right, perhaps finally, I'm just thinking about African citizens across the continent. The way this is set up, the African Union is supposed to represent us as citizens, but it seems as if we probably have no say in terms of who ends up in the top jobs on the continent.
Exactly. At the moment, that is what it is. But you remember that we have, each country has gone through its own elections and chosen a leader. And so, in a way, we've given the power of our votes to one person, that is the president or the leader in our country. And that is why, I mean, those are the leaders we are appealing to now. But in future, it is something that I'm, even just before I started the interview, someone was talking to me about this. A lot of people are now saying that, why can't we make it, you know, by popular vote? I mean, release all the 1.3 billion African citizens and give them the power to vote, to choose who leads us as a leader for Africa. But of course, at the moment, the Constitutive Act of 1999 that governs the African Union says that only 55 people are voting. So for now, that is what we have to do. But in future, yes, this can start a popular demand that the same people that have the mandate to elect their presidents and their leaders in the various countries should also be given the opportunity to participate in the voting, or maybe some sectional representation that will be more broad-based has to emerge. That is a discussion for the future. For now, we have our feet in the fire. We have only 11 days to the voting. and we are appealing to the heads of state. We've entrusted our votes, our destinies, and everything into their hands. That one vote that they are going to cast for each nation is on behalf of the millions of citizens in that nation. And our destiny is in the hands of our leaders, and we are pleading with them. Please, please save Africa now, and let's not sell out Africa to France the way things are going.